Hey everybody, Larry Beans Baxter here. I wanted to make a little short video here on how to cast a track. I was going through some supplies the other day. I found some extra casting material I had, and I thought it would be nice to practice, and I thought, why not document it while I did it? So since we're in Alaska, we're going to do something a little unique. I don't have any recent tracks or anything like that I've found to cast, but what I do have is a moose track here that I want to try and cast. I've actually got a couple of nice ones right here, probably from the same moose. And I think what I'm going to try and do is just cast both of them and see how they turn out. We've had some wet weather. It has been a little rainy. They're a little washed out. They looked a little bit better the other day. But since we got some nice weather today, I thought I'd go ahead and do it. I did cover this one up with a bucket to try and keep the rain off of it. It helped a little bit, but not very well. And that's the thing about tracks. People don't really often realize tracks are what's called transient evidence. And that means that eventually they're going to go away. They're not going to be there forever. The elements, other animals, disturbances are going to come along and make those tracks disappear. So it's important to document them when you find them. Personally, I don't often carry plaster into the field just because of the terrain I go into. It doesn't often lend itself well to casting tracks. You know, it's often very spongy, soft tundra. So, you know, probably 80% of the time, I don't even have casting materials with me. But I do like to have them in my supply stores just in case, you know, I do want to take them out with me. And I kind of want to talk about it a little bit. So what I just have here is just some regular plaster of Paris type plaster. And you can put it in a plastic bag just like that. You can put a rubber band around that, put it in your pack. I weighed it, that weighs about 14 ounces. Not really that big of a deal to carry. The water that you're gonna use to mix in this is gonna weigh more than the actual plaster does. And while we're talking about that, let me give you a little hint here. If you're gonna carry plaster and you're gonna be preparing to cast tracks, do your math at home, okay? I suck at math. I'm not really good at it. So I need things as simple as possible when I'm out in the field, when I'm dealing with things. If I'm in a hurry, there's bad weather coming, there's people walking around or animals coming through, and I've got to get this track cast. Do your math at home so you're not doing it in the field. You know, it's two parts plaster to one part water, which is pretty simple, but I've went ahead, I've got these things pre-measured out. I've got two cups of plaster in there, and I know that the water bottles I carry is two cups of water. So one of these and a half a cup of water, that's gonna be the mixture I'm gonna need to mix up some plaster to cast these tracks. All right, so I've got my plaster here. I'm ready to mix it up. I've got my water bottle. So I'm gonna take about half of this water bottle and pour it in there. So what I'm going to do next is I'm going to mix it up, and I've always been told you need the consistency, it needs to be about the consistency of pancake batter. Well, I don't know how to cook, so I don't really know what that is. My best advice is you want it to be firm, but you also want it to flow into the track, conform to the shape of the track. So you want some viscosity to it. You want it to be just a little runny, but still firm. So I'm gonna mix this up, and then we're gonna pour it into our moose track here and let it set. All right, so we got our plaster mixed up, and we're getting ready to pour it into our track now. So there's a couple of ways you can do this. One, you can just open up the bag and pour it out that way. Or two, you can take a knife or some scissors and you can cut the corner of the bag and use it like a pastry spreader or a icing spreader and use it like that. Just for cleanliness sake, I'm just gonna use the corner of the bag, and I'm gonna show you here. So what you wanna do is you wanna come in, and when you start pouring, you want to make sure it fills in the track, and you want to pour it in a back and forth motion just like that, so that you get a good amount of coverage in there. And this is
is going to work out pretty good. I think it looks like it's going to fill in the track just perfect. And you want to try and hold it kind of close too. You don't want to drop it in from up high because that'll cause deformities and bubbles and stuff like that. So you want to kind of hold your bag close. Do it just like that, weaving in and out. All right, now look at that. So the manufacturer recommends 30 to 45 minutes to let that dry. We're actually going to give that probably an hour just because the ground's so wet. We've had some rain recently, so we're going to let that cure for a little while. I'm probably going to put the bucket back over it and just let that rest, and we'll film here in a couple hours when we come out and we take it up out of the ground. Second track here. I've got my research assistant Bubbles with me, so he's gonna help. He's gonna supervise while I do this. And just with, like with our first one, you know, the manufacturer recommends about 30 to 45 minutes, but what we're going to do, we're going to give it an hour or two to cure before we come and dig it out. And another thing I forgot to mention earlier, with your cast and supplies, you can also carry around little toothpicks, or even better, some shish kebab skewers, some wooden skewers. And what you can do with those, if you have a track that is has some fragile pieces or maybe some toes that are kind of splayed out, what you can do is you can break those down to the size you need and put them into the track as you cast it. And what those little wooden dowels will do is they'll act as rebar, or they'll help support the pieces of the cast that are kind of off from the rest, that might be a little weaker or need more support. So really all you need in a good casting kit is just a plastic bag, some plaster of Paris, some water, and just any additional supplies you might need, like the toothpicks or stuff like that, depending on what you're casting, what environment you're casting, and stuff like that. You know, you may also want to have a little garden trowel or something like that to help excavate your tracks out after they're dry. But we're going to let these cure for a little while, and we'll come back and pull them out of the ground. All right, so it's been a couple hours, and I've came out here. Checked on our casts that we've made. It feels pretty solid, so I'm gonna go ahead, we're gonna remove it from the ground here. And you want to be very careful when you do this, because remember, this is plaster, this isn't concrete, so it's gonna be very fragile. So you want to carefully remove it from the ground. And look at that Bubbles. So, unlike the casts you see on the internet, a lot of times you'll see them and they'll be pristine and white and pretty. You know, you can see this has got a lot of artifact on it. It's got gravel and dirt and mud, and we're gonna have to clean that off to make it look a lot better. But this is what they look like when you pull them out in the field. They're gonna have sticks and debris and stuff in them. But you can see, once we get it cleaned off, it'll be nice and white. But it feels good, it feels solid. I don't think it's gonna fall apart on me. We're gonna set it over to the side, and we're gonna pull out the other one. All right, so now we're gonna pull the second one out. I'm gonna use the same technique as I did with the other one. Hopefully it turns out pretty much the same way. Bubbles is gonna help. We're gonna pull it out. And again, we've got some artifact, we've got some mud and some debris on there. We're gonna get it cleaned up, but it feels good, it feels solid. I think this is gonna be a good cast when it gets cleaned up. And if Bubbles doesn't eat it, we'll get to look at it here when I'm done. All right, so it's the next day, and I've had my tracks,
my tracks out here on the porch drying, and I cleaned them up a little bit, and I think they turned out pretty good. As you can see here, you know, they're a pretty good size. I mean, I've got a pretty big meat hook there, and you know, they're about the same size as my fist, and you can see some detail in these. You see this area right here. This is an area in the track where you could see where the moose had stepped in and had actually pushed down some dirt, kind of slid into the track because the ground was really soft. You can see this hoof here appears to be bigger than this one. Same thing going on with this one over here. One of the hooves appears bigger than the other one. So you can see some detail in there. There's still a lot of pebbles and dirt in there. That's just going to take time to dry off and clean off of there. You know, that mud's really wet, so it's got to dry before it can come off. But, you know, these are pretty good casts. They're pretty solid. And another thing I wanted to address is here on the back, you know, you've got this nice white slate here. You can write information if you carry a Sharpie with you out in the field. You can put time, date, location, who cast the track, anything like that on there, which is always good for documentation's sake. You know, it's always good to have, just in case you end up with a lot of casts that look the same or something happens to you, somebody will know where it came from. So I always like to do that when I make a cast of track. I always like to write information on it so that we know where it was found and where it was come from. And really, you're only limited to the space of the cast. I mean, you can put latitude, longitude, whatever you want on there as far as location. So, you know, that's a neat little tidbit, something to put in your toolbox and carry around with you as you go out into the field. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video. I really had a lot of fun making it, and hopefully we can find some nice tracks to cast in the future. And if you want to hear more, you can check out my podcast, Alasquatch. It should be available on any podcatcher. You can also check us out on Facebook at Alasquatch's Facebook page. And you can find us on the Kenai Bigfoot Research Group Facebook page as well. I'm Beans Baxter, and I've really enjoyed making this video for you. And I hope you enjoyed it too.